Hello and welcome to this session. In the earlier session, we have seen a very high-level basic architecture of Kubernetes, and we know that when we set up Kubernetes, we get a cluster. A cluster has master and worker nodes. In a worker node, there can be one or more pods, and inside pods, there can be one or more containers. And in a cluster, we can have multiple worker nodes, and we can have one or more master node, and the master controls or manages the workers. So this is at a very high level we have seen the architecture of Kubernetes. In this session we will go a little more deeper and see the awesome architecture of Kubernetes. So let's get started. Hello and welcome. I'm Raghav. I'm a teacher and you can find all my work on my website automationstepbystep.com. In this session, we are going to learn the architecture of Kubernetes, and this is part 2 of this session. In this session, I'm going to go very basic step by step, so do not worry if you are a complete beginner. We will learn the basic architecture of Kubernetes and we will see the 4 components of master node, the 3 components of worker node, add-ons, and how master and worker nodes interact with each other. And by the end of this session, you will have a really good understanding on the architecture of Kubernetes. So let's get started. And we already know this image. We have seen this diagram. In a cluster, we have master and worker nodes, and the master manages the worker nodes. In worker nodes, we have pods, and pods have containers. Now, if we talk about the master node, or master in a Kubernetes cluster, it is responsible for managing the cluster, and it basically monitors and manages the nodes and the pods in a cluster. So whenever there is a failure or a failure of a node, it will take care and move the workload of the failed node to some other working node, and it will take care of the overall working in the Kubernetes cluster. Now, master has 4 components, and these are API server. API server is responsible for all the communications. Then we have scheduler. Scheduler schedules the pods on nodes. It can read the configuration from a configuration file, and accordingly, it selects the nodes where the pods can be scheduled. Then we have controller manager. This is a component that has some controllers that runs some monitors and then manages the activities. We will learn about this in detail. And then we have etcd or etcd, which is an open source database or a key value data store where all the data is present. So these are the 4 major components in Kubernetes master. Let us learn about each component one by one. Let us start with API server. API server is responsible for all the communication, and API server exposes some APIs that the users can interact. So to interact with API server, we use some APIs, and to call the APIs, we can use a command line tool or from a UI. So you can understand this in a very easy way. API server exposes some APIs for every communication or operation, and a user can interact with these APIs or call these APIs from a command line or from a dashboard UI. The command line tool is called kubectl. And when we use command line to call the APIs, we actually use kubectl, and then we can also use Kubernetes dashboard, that is the UI. So kubectl is the command line tool, or you can say kubectl is the command line utility used to interact with the Kubernetes API, which is written in Go programming languages. And this is a very important interview question as well, that in Kubernetes, we do all the communication using API server. The API server exposes some APIs, and a user can interact with this API using command line through kubectl utility or from a UI using the Kubernetes dashboard. So this is about API server. Then we come to scheduler. Now scheduler is a component that schedules pods across multiple nodes. Now we know that in Kubernetes, worker nodes can be a physical or a virtual machine, and they can have different infrastructure or hardware configurations. Now scheduler knows about these configurations of nodes, and whenever it has to schedule a pod, it will check what node will fit best for the configuration or hardware requirements of a pod, and accordingly it will schedule the pod on the required node. So this is a component on master that watches newly created pods that have no node assigned and selects a node for them to run, and it obtains all this information from etcd. Again, a very important information to remember for interviews. Scheduler gets all the information from configuration files and indirectly from the etcd data store. So this was about scheduler. Now let us move on to control manager. Now control manager is a component in master that has different controllers which runs different monitors. Now here we have kube control manager and cloud control manager. Now kube control manager runs some monitors that will inform the master in case there is any node which has failed or is not available, so that the necessary actions can be taken. And then we also have cloud control manager. Sometimes when we are using the infrastructure of a cloud provider, all the monitors that needs to run for interacting with the cloud service provider or the infrastructure of the cloud provider is done through cloud control manager. Now when we talk about kube control manager, these are the different controllers: node controller, replication controller, endpoints controller, and service account and token controllers. So in simple words, these controllers or the kube control manager will make sure that nodes are running all the time. It will also check the health of the cluster and also check the correct number of pods are running as per the specifications file. A very important information and an interview question: these controllers are all separate processes. However, to reduce the complexity, they are compiled into a single binary and run as a single process. So you will not find a separate binary or a separate bat file for every controller. You will find a single file or a single process. However, these are actually internally separate processes. Now, if we go a little more deeper, if we talk about node controller, it is responsible for monitoring the nodes, and whenever a node goes down, it will send a signal. Then we have replication controller, and it checks the correct number of pods as per the configuration files are maintained. Endpoint controllers is responsible for maintaining all the services and communications. Then we have service account and token controllers, and it is responsible for maintaining accounts and API access and all these namespaces. So these are the controllers under kube control manager. Now to understand all this in simple words, all these controllers runs some monitors in loops which will take care of the health of the cluster, and it will take care of the configuration and the desired infrastructure. Whenever there is some mismatch or something is not as per the configurations, it will send the signals or take necessary action and send the communication to the required component, which will then take some actions as required. Now if we talk about cloud control manager, so this has some monitors that interact with the cloud service providers, and here again we have node controller, route controller, service controller, and volume controller. So all these are responsible for managing and maintaining interaction with the cloud service provider. So this is something you can understand at a high level. What is the use of these controllers and control manager? Now something that you can remember for interviews, in case you want to disable the controller loops, you can do this by setting the cloud provider flag. This is something we will see later when we do some practicals. So this was about the control manager component in a Kubernetes master. Let us go to the last component of Kubernetes master, that is the etcd or the etcd data store. And we have seen this is an open source distributed key value data store in Kubernetes, and this stores all the data in a Kubernetes cluster. Now an important thing here to remember is only API server is the component that can directly interact with the etcd data store. There is no other component that will interact with etcd directly. It will only through API server. So this is something you should remember. Now etcd can be a part of Kubernetes master, or it can also be configured externally. So in the image that you see on your screen, it is a part of Kubernetes master. However, we can also configure it externally, and the communication process will remain the same. So these are the four components of master node: API server, scheduler, controller manager, and etcd. API server is responsible for all the communications. Scheduler schedules pods on nodes based on the configurations. We have Control Manager that runs some controllers and monitors. Then etcd, which is an open source distributed key value data store or database for the Kubernetes master or Kubernetes cluster in general. So I hope you understand all these four components, and this is how our master looks like. Now we have to see the components of a worker node and how exactly master interacts with the worker node. Now we will first see the components of a worker node, and then we will see how the interaction takes place. So we know a worker node can be a physical or virtual machine in a Kubernetes cluster, and every node should run a container runtime environment like Docker. And we have these three components in a worker node: kubelet, kube-proxy, and container runtime. Now these components run on every node, and they are responsible for maintaining the pods and providing the Kubernetes runtime environment. So let us understand these three components in a little more detail. We will start with kubelet. Now kubelet is a agent or a utility running on each worker node, and it is the component that interacts with the master node using the API server. Kubelet gets the information from some specs called pod specs, and based on those specifications, it makes sure the containers are running accordingly on the pods. Now, in case there is any issue with any pod, it will try to restart the pod on the same node, or if required, it will start the pod on a different node. So you can understand kubelet as a component or an agent running on each node, which makes sure the containers are running in a pod, and whenever there is an issue with a pod, it will start the pod on the same or a different node, and it also interacts with the master component using the API server. Now, an important information to remember in general and for interviews is kubelet will only manage the containers which are created by Kubernetes. In case you have any containers running on the node or the machine which were not created by Kubernetes, it will not manage those containers. So this is about kubelet. Let us go to the second component, which is kube-proxy. Now kube-proxy is the core networking component in a node, and it can also interact with the external world. And this is a component or an agent which is responsible for maintaining the network configuration and the rules. So kube-proxy is the networking component in Kubernetes. Now a very important information or interview question: all nodes run daemon called kube-proxy, which watches the API server on the master node, so it can interact or communicate with the master node using API server, and it gets all the information for addition or removal of services and the endpoints. So this is all about kube-proxy. Now let us move to the third component, that is container runtime. And we know that in a node, we can have one or more pods, and every pod can have one or more containers. And this is how we maintain a container runtime in a node in Kubernetes. So in simple words, container runtime is a software that is responsible for running containers. And the most common container platform used with Kubernetes is Docker. So in a node, we have pods, and pods have containers. Now with Kubernetes, we can use several container runtimes. Docker is the most common and widely used, but there are some other container platforms or runtime engines like Containerd, Cryo, Rocketlet, and Kubernetes CRI. All this we can use with Kubernetes. So in simple words, Kubernetes does not have the capability to directly handle containers, and it needs a container runtime like Docker. And that is what the component container runtime is all about. So these are the basic three components of a Kubernetes worker node. Now we can also have some add-ons for doing some monitoring and logging, etc. These are some extended functionalities in Kubernetes. Now we can have some add-ons for creating a dashboard, monitoring, logging, and DNS. So dashboard can be used as a web-based user interface for cluster management. Then we have monitoring add-ons for collecting some metrics. We can also do some logging using some add-ons, and then we have DNS related add-ons. So these are some additional or extended functionality of Kubernetes. Now let us come back to our node. We have already learned and understood about the different components of a worker node, and we have also seen the different components in a master node. So this is a complete picture of a master and a worker node, and how do they interact with each other. You can see here The API server component of the master node can interact with kube-proxy and kubelet component of the worker node, and this is how the flow of information takes place. In the master node, we have API server, scheduler, control manager, and etcd. In the worker node, we have kubelet, kube-proxy, and container runtime like Docker. And all this is a part of a cluster in Kubernetes. And we have already seen in a cluster, there can be multiple nodes, and they can also be one or more master, and the master controls or manages the worker nodes. I hope now you have a very good understanding on the architecture of Kubernetes. In the coming session, we will start installing and using Kubernetes. I hope this session was very useful for you. Thank you for watching.